He killed people and then he turned them into tashi brine.
Let's not say that.
Do you have any idea what that is? It's kimchi brine.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Hey everyone, my name is Philip Wang. Welcome to another episode of Spill the Boba Tea, a show where I invite special guests over to Bopomofo Cafe for a private and exclusive experience where we make a drink that's based on the life and career of my special guest. Tonight we have an icon and legend in the cafe, Margaret Cho, everyone.
Yay!
She is an actress, a stand-up comedian, an author, a musician, a fashion designer, and tonight a barista. Margaret is also a pioneer for Asian Americans in Hollywood as the creator of the first ever primetime network sitcom to star an Asian American family. She has also been recognized and given countless awards for her work in advocating for women's rights and LGBTQ+ rights as well. It is an honor. I'm inspired and I'm super nervous to be sitting
Thank
in your
you.
Presence right now, Margaret.
I'm so honored. Thank you.
Do you know anything about this show? Did you do any type of research?
I did some research and I just was like, I wonder what kind of drink
All right.
it's gonna be like.
Don't look at the ingredients
yet. Does it have 1,000-year-old egg in it? Because that would be,
because
I'm so old, it would be like, I would need a century egg.
I will admit that coming up with your drink was a challenge. The main reason why is because your career and your life is so eclectic.
It's all over the place.
It is, and honestly, this drink is gonna be a little all over the place too. I will say I only brought 2 cups. I didn't bring a mini cup for your little
Lucia,
guest here.
Lucia, her name is Lucia.
Katerina.
Katerina. But her Korean name is Cho Rucha.
Cho
Rucha.
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 Rucha. What does that mean?
I don't know, maybe tea? Cha?
Okay, perfect.
She's perfect for hair.
There it is. All right, so we're gonna kick it off with our first ingredient. It's not actually an ingredient that's gonna go into the drink, but it's actually gonna set a mood for us.
Mm.
So what we have right here is some dry ice.
Ooh.
And the reason why I chose dry ice is because when we pour water over it, we get some fog, and you know, I just wanted to set the mood because you grew up in San Francisco. This is just basically me wanting to talk about San Francisco with you.
I love it, I love it.
I grew up in the Bay Area as well.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up in the East Bay though.
Okay.
But you grew up in the Sunset District.
Yes.
Your story with your parents owning a gay bookstore, when was this happening?
This was in the 1970s. My parents bought a gay bookstore because my father loves male attention.
Okay.
Because he believes that South Korea's greatest export is male beauty, which is true.
Hey, it's caught up, you know?
He loves it when men compliment him and he gets all excited. And all over his house,
wow,
there's all these paintings of my dad in his 30s.
From his admirers.
From his many, 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 many admirers. So, you know, we had this bookstore and it was a very big, bustling community place. But, you know, my family were just kind of there, very, very different. They were such immigrants. They were so Korean.
Yeah.
So different to have a business like that.
Sounds like you had to grow up very quickly too.
Sort of. My father kind of pushed me to ask all of the people that worked for him about art and music and fashion and photography and to find out about what life was really about.
Yeah.
From all of these young men who were working for Harvey Milk, who were going out and doing drag, who were getting dressed up in leather and going on motorcycles, which my dad would let me go on motorcycles with leather daddies.
Because the stereotype is that Asian parents are super strict. Why do you think your parents are so different?
Because when you bring a painting of my father to my father, he's gonna let you do whatever you want. I mean, because he's very vague. It's very funny, but it's very indicative of the idea that my parents were kind of very independent thinkers, which I think in their class, in their generation of like Koreans, you know, was very unusual.
Yeah, no, and obviously it trickled down into their child.
I guess so, yeah,
a little bit. I was gonna ask, like, you know, what is the most favorite touristy thing? And then what is your most favorite, like, no one knows this thing about San Francisco?
My favorite touristy thing actually is probably Chinatown, which isn't that touristy, but I do love just going to get dim sum in some of these crowded places and just walking around.
Yeah.
I love a Chinese bakery.
What's your go-to thing at the bakery?
Well, my chashu bao, but I'm also—
Same! Steamed or baked?
I think it's gonna be steamed. If I had a choice.
Okay.
To be steamed, but I would rather have both steamed and baked.
Got it. And then most favorite, like no one knows this, kind of like you have to be local to know.
So I collect vintage t-shirts.
Okay.
And I have a vast collection of like, it's mostly rock t-shirts, but some things I go like a joke t-shirt. So I go to these very specialized vintage clothing marts that are just designed just for t-shirt collectors, yeah. And it's real dorky.
Oh.
So it's kind of like, you know how people are sneakerheads?
Okay.
There's people who are t-shirt heads,
oh,
which
wow.
I am
I didn't know that.
Very into. There are things that have been worn by people. They have the stains of people from
the armpit stains and
blood wow. and like ketchup. And I think it's a really beautiful collection.
Yeah.
So that's like San Francisco is like the best place to go for those specific kinds of collectors things. So that's why I go.
Got it. Okay. I'm gonna try to ask you for the hookup next time of where to go.
On
to our next ingredient. So we have some cucumber juice and some mint.
Yummy.
So the reason why I have these two ingredients is because I watched the pilot of All American Girl.
Mm-hmm.
All American Girl, if you guys don't know, is a sitcom that Margaret created in the 90s, and it was the first ever primetime network sitcom to star an Asian American family. And I watched the pilot, and you worked at like a skincare center or like
that's
in the mall.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You're
mm-hmm.
giving out perfume samples,
right.
talking about a skin computer. And you know what? Cucumbers are very good for the skin.
That's true.
I know it's a little bit of a stretch, but that's
I
how
love
we got
it.
Here.
I think
that's how
great.
We got here.
I think that's great.
Before we talk about All American Girl,
mm-hmm.
let's do this first. Why don't you pick out just a couple sprigs of mint? So we're gonna muddle this first.
Mm-hmm.
Alright, here you can go first. I'll open that for you. All right, we're gonna pour 350 cc's of the cucumber juice. All right, there it goes. Smells great.
It smells delicious.
So yeah, there's so much to talk about with this show. You know, I think a lot of people that might be watching maybe even weren't even around in the
90s. Oh yeah, yeah.
And I think it's so important for us to understand like the landscape of entertainment at the time and how different it is from today or even just like 5 years ago. I mean, I know this is a very broad question, but you know, how did that show even come about at that
well,
time?
Well, there was a lot of comedians that were getting their own TV shows and becoming very successful from them. You know, Seinfeld, of
yeah.
course, and Tim Allen. And they were looking for a comedian who was different.
Mm-hmm.
And I was doing stand-up comedy, and so that was perfect for me. So they developed the show around my stand-up comedy, which didn't really work because my stand-up comedy also is very adult and very raunchy, but they didn't know how to make that work for, like, kid growing up in a Korean household.
Yeah.
So it was like, how do you make that happen? And it was very much this weird thing. Like I look back and I think, well, I think television then couldn't have supported our show the way that I would have done it as a comedian.
Totally, yeah.
You know, I was able to do specials on cable and stuff.
Right.
But they didn't necessarily really have television shows like that yet.
So it was only on network. You had to kind of water it down. But you were also pretty young when you did get mm-hmm. to do the show.
Yeah.
Because there weren't that many, you know, Asian projects that were out there. It seems like to go from nothing to here's an entire show, that's a lot of pressure.
It was a huge amount of pressure, but also it was like there was no idea of like Asian American anything.
Yeah.
You know, and that was even a new subject to broach
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
for people.
Right.
But it was emerging. You know, we had a magazine called Giant Robot,
yep.
which was very important
right.
and very crucial to sort of our understanding of who we are, getting to understand ourselves as a community and like a young community. It was really a different time.
Yeah, and from what I've heard and talked about with peers too, it was also met with a lot of resistance from this emerging community that was still trying to find its identity.
Oh yeah, right? But it was timing because the show premiered fall after the LA riots.
Oh my God.
So it was the first time Koreans had seen themselves after their rooftops with
oh
rifles.
Oh my God, yeah.
So they were so alarmed, and then, you know, all of these like muksa names, you know, like pastors, were watching my stand-up comedy.
Oh, God.
Oh,
God.
So it was upsetting for a lot of the older Korean community who were like, we don't understand what this is about.
Yeah.
They were scared, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But what was great was all their kids saw it, and they were so thrilled because it was the first time they got to see Asian Americans on television, which is really incredible.
Hearing you kind of like recap how it was, and it really does sound like it was too soon for its time, or like it was ahead of it so far.
Totally.
Right? Imagine if it were to come out now, like is it something where at the time, that community just wasn't connected yet, we didn't have the way to galvanize, is that kind of like what was kind of against it?
Well, I think it was more like there was a community that was here that had very much still identified with being from their country of origin. Oh. So they didn't necessarily completely identify with being Asian American.
Yeah.
Their kids definitely felt Asian American.
Right, right.
But the adults were sort of making those decisions. So it was a weird kind of balance of like culture, but also generation.
Right.
It was such a different time because we were totally invisible in the world.
I mean, I guess so it took over 20 years for the next family with Fresh Off the Boat. How does it feel to see it, like kind of just the seed that you planted way back then to kind of sprout?
It's so great. Yeah. It's great. I want to see more. I think it's really exciting. You know, it's just like society catching up to realize like we have to create our own work. If I look back, I was like, oh, well, my greatest achievement was really to influence a whole generation of people to go and do it, which is really awesome. So I'm very proud of that.
And you definitely have, and you're still doing it, recapping your career. There's so much, I actually had to like take notes because I was like, there's just too much. There's honestly like so much to talk about. We can make a flight of drinks for you.
I love it.
But the next ingredient is actually some honeydew syrup.
Ooh, chame.
Yes, so this is actually, you know, made from real honeydew. And the reason why I chose honeydew is because, did you know that honeydew melons are what tattoo artists practice on?
I did not know that.
I did not know that either until I Wikipedia'd it. You obviously have a ton of tattoos.
I do.
And I was gonna ask, just what is your favorite tattoo or what is your most meaningful tattoo?
I think the first ones that I have, which are the ones on my stomach and my back, which is like I have like 15 snakes on me. And then I have two very large chrysanthemums and peonies, it's Japanese style. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So it was done by Ed Hardy.
Oh my God.
So those are my favorite.
How old were you when you got your first ones?
30?
Okay, so you're relatively new to, like, you know, it wasn't like a teenage kind of like
Yeah,
thing.
But I mean, you know, to me it's sort of like been a while. I mean, I'm 52, so it's been a while.
You don't act or look like it, but.
That's good.
Yes. Do you have any that were like not planned or that were kind of like on
a dare? None of them were really planned.
Oh, really?
So they're all kind of like.
Like you're just like, Ed Hardy, hey, come on over. I just kind of
well,
feel
we,
like.
We definitely, he and I planned it, but everybody else, like I have a whole bunch of tattoos from people from all over the world and they were all just people that I wanted to hang out with.
Okay.
People who are friends of mine, old friends, new friends, and you know, I love the art form.
Yeah.
Although I don't think I have any more skin, and it's hard if you're an actor.
Oh.
You just don't, I don't know. I mean, The Rock gets away with it, of course.
Well, yeah, I feel like that's part of his like attire now, just like a tank top, and that's just like what he always wears. But I think it's so cool. I have not been brave enough to take that plunge into the art
form. It hurts.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, the first thing whenever you talk to someone that gets their tattoo, it's always like, it hurts so
bad. It hurts so bad.
And it's not good marketing for them.
No, it hurts so bad. And then you're like, oh, why did I get that? And then you don't see it after a while. It's weird how they kind of disappear because they're just part of you.
Have you forgotten?
Totally forgot.
With that said, we're going to put some of this honeydew syrup into this mixture. So it's going to be 1 ounce of honeydew. All right. It's right in.
This is beautiful. It's so green.
All right, so we got the honeydew in there. We know all about your favorite tattoos. Time for our next ingredient to be brought out. The next ingredient is... Do you have any idea what that is? Can you smell it now?
Lychee?
No, it's kimchi brine.
Oh, yummy.
Yeah.
So that's great,
so,
a little spice.
Yes, a little bit of spice. The reason why I chose kimchi brine, which like you said, we could just drink this by itself.
So good, it's just cabbage water, gochugaru, salt.
You know, I wanted to bring in an ingredient that was a little, you know, kind of change things up a little bit.
Delicious.
And also because you are and have been very proud of your Korean heritage from the beginning of your career. And I think that's amazing because I think in Hollywood, it's very difficult. You know, you talk to a lot of actors who felt like they had to hide it or that they didn't really accept it until like later on, but you've been there. And I think that's really cool because I relate to that as well. You know, I think it's great to have that pride. So I got to ask you, right now, like how you is taking over the world, it's not a Korean wave to you. You've been on that wave. I got to ask, like, what are you watching? What do you watch the K-dramas?
I do. I love Vincenzo. I loved Sweet Home. I'm on Penthouse 3.
Man,
making some missteps, Penthouse 3.
How do you feel about this wave? You know, or like, is this something that you've been waiting to happen?
I love it. I've been watching movies and television from Asia since the 90s. Like, my favorite movies were like Hong Kong movies with like Chow Yun-fat and John Woo movies, you know, because we never saw ourselves in America.
And the only way to watch it was to go to the Asian like video stores.
Yeah, and then, you know, I loved like all of the Hong Kong like Category 3 movies, like all the horror is really crazy. My favorite is The Untold Story.
I can't do horror either.
If you like Cha Siu Bao, you can't watch.
probably not.
Can't watch Untold Story. Yeah. Well, Untold Story is about a murderer who had a restaurant. He killed people and then he turned them into Cha Siu Bao.
Let's not say that bad mojo here.
No, it's delicious. The reason horror is so popular is because the summer is so hot and humid in Asia that the way that they cool off is to go to scary movies. Because they get chills.
So like they'll get the literal chills.
The goosebumps. You get chills from like watching a scary movie in that proxy of air conditioning.
That's very, you know, efficient and very economical.
It's very Asian.
Yeah. We will not get an air conditioner, but we will go get that VCD right now.
We'll just be scared.
Yeah. And any favorite artists, music artists that you like?
I love BTS. You know, they did a big like live streaming event with their fans. It was just so like beautiful.
You are ARMY. You were there at the event.
Oh yeah, I'm like five-star general. love ITZY. Okay. I'm a Blink. Blackpink.
All right, so you're on that current wave right now. What about the old school ones?
I mean, for me, it's like all about Trot and like, I mean, old school, like Super Junior.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, all
H.O.T. I'm talking H.O.T. Yeah, Big Bang, obviously.
I love. And then I love Girls' Generation. Like, yes. I love all of the different waves of K-pop.
So now we're at our final step before we combine everything. And what I wanted to do is actually prepare the cup that we're going to pour this in. So we have these colored sprinkles, purple, blue, and fuchsia pink. And the reason why I chose these colors are because these are the colors of the bisexual flag.
Yay!
And I definitely wanted to talk to you about, you know, your journey and your experiences and your advocacy for the queer community.
Mm-hmm.
And just like, you know, the fact that you've been doing it for so long, what kind of keeps you driven to continue speaking up and I guess, yeah, being that inspiration for them?
Well, I think it's really important, and we still have a lot of anti-trans legislation out there that people are trying to ban trans kids. Like, it's a very terrifying future that we have if we're like thinking about like trans kids being a threat. You know, it's like a very strange way to attack our community. And
yeah.
So it's very sad and it's really frightening. So we need to keep on being very vocal and being very active in fighting against this kind of bigotry and discrimination. So it's very important.
Another thing too that I was just reading about it, like even the word bisexual is a word that you kind of have wrestled with yourself in terms of.
Yeah, like, I don't like the term because it really seems to, you know, refer to the fact that there may only be two genders, which I think is wrong as well, because I know a lot of people who identify as non-binary.
Right.
You know, it's a binary look at, a binary word, which we don't need, but at the same time, we do need something.
Right.
So I think you know, it's a problematic word.
I see what you're saying. I think in a lot of communities, and even just, you know, just speaking of like the Asian American community, there's things where like, if we were to be really picky, yeah, we probably wouldn't have that or we wouldn't do that, but we understand in the greater picture, it's kind of necessary
It's like microwave rice. You know, even though we should wash it and soak it,
yeah,
it's still pretty good.
The Korean brands only though.
Otogi,
Koreans, like
it's
they
really
mastered
good.
It somehow, the technology.
It's so good.
I don't know how you guys did it. All right, so we're gonna make this rim. We have to make it like basically the lines of the sugar on the plate. All right, so I'm guessing you've done sugar rims before.
No, never.
Okay,
never.
Cool. Let's do it then. That makes me very excited. We're doing things that Margaret hasn't done before. We're gonna take a lime, and we're just gonna put the juice around the rim. Oh my God, please work. Hey!
Oh, that's beautiful.
Hey, that actually looks pretty nice.
Yeah, it looks really nice.
All right, cool. So same thing. So just try to go straight down and then like try to get it all around. Hey, not bad.
Beautiful.
I like it. All right, time to combine it all. Combine the melon and the cucumber with the kimchi brine. We're gonna put 1 ounce at the bottom of this cup. That's what we're going here for. Are you ready? So we're just gonna pour right over. Oh, see, look at that beautiful gradient.
Oh yeah, that's beautiful.
To top this off, we're gonna put some actual honeydew and of course, some boba balls. We're ready for you. We're just gonna put it actually on the top. Usually the toppings go on the bottom, but I just thought, you know, I feel like Margaret, she does things her own way.
Yeah.
We're gonna do things a little different.
This is so beautiful.
Also on the top.
Oh, I love it.
All right. And this, my friends, is, I should have thought of a name. Last time I tried naming a drink, we almost got pulled off YouTube. Ross's Jacked Milk.
I don't like the sound of that at all.
Jackfruit. It's because it's jackfruit. Ryan, what, you want to name this?
The Cho Chug.
The Cho Chug. Dude.
Yay.
That's really good. I like that a lot. All right, we got the Bi Flag Sugar Rim. We got kimchi brine as a base. We got a cucumber melon water juice and melon bits in there. There's a lot going on here, but I think that's representative of you, Margaret,
because I love
you
it.
Got a lot going on, but yeah. It's also very beautiful as you are as well.
I love it, thank you.
How it tastes though, I can't guarantee.
Well, we'll taste it and we'll see.
All right, so what we're gonna do is, we're gonna mix it up. That's good. Look at how it changed color, okay. Time to try the Cho Chug.
Oh, very refreshing.
Yo, that's really interesting.
Really interesting.
The kimchi actually plays.
It works.
You get a little bit of that heat in the back.
Mm-hmm. You know what's interesting? It's just the colors throw me off.
You're right, because it's like, you wouldn't expect this flavor to come out of.
Yeah, because the color is so like, it's like such a beautiful like green tea, like celadon, and a very earthy taste.
That kind of works.
Mm-hmm.
I think we might have been the first people to ever do kimchi boba.
You know what it tastes like? Cucumber kimchi.
Oh, yeah, yeah, wait, like the banchan?
Yeah.
Yes. Ooh. I think we did something special here.
It's really good.
Well, cheers, Margaret.
Cheers, cheers. Thank you.
Thank you for the Cho Cho Chug. Thank you for hanging out at Bopomofo. Congratulations on everything you're doing these days and still to come. I can't wait to see, and you're such an inspiration, so really appreciate you being here tonight.
Thank you, I appreciate this. This is wonderful. Watch my movie, Good on Paper. It's out on Netflix now.
Pairs perfectly with the Cho Cho Chug. We gave you all the ingredients, the list to make it at home. So tag Margaret with your reaction.
I'll make this at home with my own kimchi.
Yeah. All right, thanks everyone.